All right, everyone. So I'm going to start my talk about Cloud Foundry, platform automation with Concurse. My name is Dennis. I'm with Anylines. I'm platform engineer in the enterprise operations team. I do some support, some operations, and most of the time I don't try to do everything twice, which means I'm heavily working on our automation concept for operations. Some of you might also know me as the valued underling of this guy. This is Sven. This is our technical lead for the platform. He made some advertisement for me in the CF operations channel. Okay, what we are talking about. So we have a product which is tightly connected into Cloud Foundry. And this means we are dealing with several problems. On the one side, we have open source releases we need to update regularly, like your UEA, for example, your Garden release and your Cloud Foundry. On the other side, we have our own software releases, in our example, it's about our data services we need to update. We have to update the Bosch stem cells, and we have to maintain our Cloud Foundry runtime. So, and this talk is about how we're gonna deliver a software release with all these components to our customer systems. And that's not a trivial task because our customers, they are using different infrastructures. Some are using AWS, some are using Azure, some are already using Alibaba Cloud. They have multiple Bosch directors. They are running multiple systems at once, which means like they have a staging environment, they have a second staging environment, they have another production environment, a second production environment. And they have multiple of these environments, which means like they have a setup on GCP, they have a setup on AWS, they have a setup on Azure. And we need to be able to constantly and continuously ship new software releases to all these systems every week. And the question, of course, is how are we going to do it? We're going to do it with Concurse. So let's look into our deployment process. On the left side, we have our CI/CD system, which somehow gets some deployment manifests, mostly from a GitHub repository, and sends this deployment manifest to our Bosch director, which is actually downloading all the releases from the release repositories and S3 buckets into the director blob store and then provisions our deployments. But actually, the tricky question about this is what we're going to put into this deployment manifest, because we are not just supporting one infrastructure, we are supporting multiple infrastructures. And we also have completely different environments. The one production system of customer A might need 10 Tiego cells, the other production system might require 50. So we are in a position where we cannot just hard code everything into the deployment manifest. So what we figure out, which worked quite good for us, is we separate it. We have an environment-specific configuration, which means you have this specific production environment, and we split the configuration of this production environment in an IIS config, in a Bosch ops files, and in a cloud config. And what it makes us enabling to do is we can specify how many Tiego cells you want. We can specify which networks you want. We can specify which VM types, persistent disk types. And we are able to completely manipulate the deployment manifest with Bosch operation files. Of course, we are not saving the credentials in the GitHub. So we're working with a credential store. For us, it's CredHub. But I mean, you can use pretty much everything which is supported. For example, HashiCorp Vault. And the last thing is the bare-bone deployment manifest. This is like just like the deployment manifest, which tells like, we have this deployment name, it has these instance groups, these jobs, and these releases. And all the rest gets enriched with the environment configuration and the cloud config, which is already at the Bosch director. So, and that's how it's really looking. Our CI/CD knows we are now in the production environment of customer A. So we need to get the environment config from customer A. We take the Bosch manifests. And then we enrich the Bosch manifest with the IIS config. We update the cloud config at the Bosch director. And we might also change something on the deployment manifest with Bosch operation files. We send this complete deployment manifest to the director, and the director will then go to your credential store of choice and take all the credentials. So we can make this like into a CI/CD process. So first we're gonna take all our resources, like the open source releases, the stem cells, and our own releases. We make a build step. At the end of this build step, we have something we call the release candidate, which is like a release YAML file, which contains all the manifests you need to deploy your Cloud Foundry, for example, to deploy your brokers, to register your brokers. Then we go and take this information and we deploy it on our staging environment. And afterwards, we run a test suite and a security scanning. So after that, you can tell that the deploying first is migrating and second, it's not completely broken. So if we finish the security scanning, we now have something we call the final release. So, but right now we have, again, one problem. We have different infrastructures. If we are gonna test this just, for example, on a vSphere infrastructure, it doesn't mean that it's working on Azure, on AWS, or any other infrastructure. So, this concept right now does not have a multi-infrastructure support. So what we're gonna do, we're gonna take the deploy step, the run test suite step, and the security scanning, and just put it into another box. So we build our release candidate, and then we're gonna distribute it to different pipelines. And the job of these different pipelines is to test it on AWS, on Azure, on vSphere, and creating a final release for this specific infrastructure. So afterwards, I'm able to tell with the AWS release, I'm able to migrate the software on AWS. And we call this process the release builder. So, but your problem is not only about deploying Bosch. We figured out that there are like several layers of problems. It starts with your infrastructure automation. Then you have your Bosch directors, you need to provision them. You also need to update the stem cells, you need to update the releases of the director. Then you have your deployments. Cloud Foundry is part of your deployments, the brokers are part of your deployments. You need to update again releases, stem cells. And you have, sometimes you have also default applications you push on your runtime. And when you run the pipeline the first time, you want to make sure that it gets also carried out by the CI/CD system. So looking at these different problems, we figured out that they are all basically the same. The only thing that really changes is the tooling. So for example, for infrastructure automation, you're gonna use Terraform for Azure, or you're gonna use CloudFormation for AWS, you're gonna use Bosch CLI to provision your directors, you're gonna use Bosch and Cloud Foundry for your deployments, and again, you're gonna use Cloud Foundry to deploy your applications. So what we did, we described a process which can be applied for all of these layers. In our process, we always go at first, we provide a release which triggers the CI/CD pipeline, then we provision something, and then afterwards, we're gonna test this. For example, if you provision your Cloud Foundry runtime, you want to make sure that your users can actually create an org in space, that you can create your services with your brokers, that you actually can reach the Cloud Foundry API. And all these steps, they can fail. So if you are migrating the Cloud Foundry manifest, you're deploying it, and it's failing, it's gonna get a feedback loop back to the release, which means you're running the CI/CD, you see it didn't work, it breaks from this point. The operator needs to figure out why the release was not working, and then you need to cut a new release and start the process over. So either it fails on migration or on testing and it goes back, or it continues. So now you can make a big process getting all this layer together. First you're gonna automate the infrastructure, then you're gonna provision your Bosch directors and update them, then you do your Bosch deployments, and at the very end you may do your CF applications. But actually, it's not that simple. So if you're familiar with Conkrus, it's also mostly a Bosch deployment. So when you want to run a pipeline, you need to have a Conkrus first, which means you need a Bosch director, and you also need to have a running infrastructure underneath. So we're dealing with a chicken or the egg problem here. And what we figured out makes this problem much easier to solve is to separate the Conkrus environment from the rest of the environment. So we came up with something we called the slave Conkrus. We're gonna explain a little bit more later why this is called slave Conkrus. And it actually, in our case, has a credential store. We're using CredHub. It has a Bosch director, and it has the Conkrus deployment. So, and this slave Conkrus is able to bootstrap all the other resources needed for your customer environment. This means like multiple directors. And at the very end, we are also able to provision new directors with a Bosch director, which means all the directors you see underneath, they are actually deployed with the slave Conkrus director, which makes it very easy to bootstrap new directors and to monitor them. So we call this a customer environment. And yeah, I mean, obviously it's pretty cool. We have a unified credential store, which means all these directors underneath, they use the CredHub from the slave Conkrus. Ultimately, it gives us the opportunity to connect our Conkrus directly with this CredHub and to get all the credentials we need in order to deploy all the directors automatically. I mean, technically, you could also give the Conkrus just a credentials file, but think about it. What if you just rotate some certificates in Cloud Foundry? You always need to change the credentials in the Conkrus as well. So using directly the CredHub of all these directors makes it much easier. Every time you run the pipeline, it's going to have the latest credentials from these directors. So, yeah, of course, when we have a slave Conkrus, we also have a master Conkrus. And what our master Conkrus actually is, it's this one component which is bootstrapping the slave. So it's providing the infrastructure for the slave, it's deploying the director of the slave, and then it's deploying the Conkrus of the slave, and uploads all the pipelines which the slave needs. So why are we using this? So this is like the complete system is looking like. You have an AWS release, you have an Azure release, which is built by the release builder. These releases go, for example, into a S3 bucket. Cool. Then the AWS staging of the first customer is going to be triggered, and it's going to migrate the release, test it. And when it's working, it's going to trigger the next stage. And the next stage is, again, it's going to migrate it, test it, and ship it to the production system. The same thing is also working if you have a staging system into two production systems. At the very end, it's just like about how you trigger the releases. So the process doesn't change. You just need to think about who is the next one who's going to receive this release. So you have to play a little bit release ping pong at the very end. Okay, we still didn't talk why we need this Conkrus in the setup. So think about this. We have this AWS staging, Azure staging, and all the others. But there must be one single instance which is providing all this and is also maintaining the Conkrus pipelines. And this is what the master is about. It's provisioning all the directors, and it's also distributing new pipelines. So, for example, you create a new pipeline, and you want to make it enable in all the customer environments. How are you going to do it? You need to go to 6, 8, or 10 different environments, and every time you need to update the Conkrus pipelines there, which can be really tedious. This is just an example of a single customer, but maybe you have like 5 customers. Then you're facing like, I don't know, 30 different environments, and every time you need to update the pipelines. That's why we have this Conkrus master. And every customer system has one of these masters, which is able to distribute the pipelines just for this one customer system. So yeah, that's about our CI/CD system. Thank you for having me here. It's actually a picture from a water taxi we experienced on Monday. I didn't know that something like this already exists. So yeah, you have any questions? No questions? Yeah?
Do you have any struggles with like the hardware? Like how much hardware do you need to run your course?
Yeah, I mean, actually our own staging environment is running on vSphere, and we are kind of limited on resources there. So it really depends what you have, right? We have not just only the runtime, but we also have all the brokers, which is like right now, I think we have 8 brokers or something. Then we have something for DNS, we have console, and we have an Nginx, so it gets pretty heavy. But I mean, you can go there and prune something like, you don't have to have 50 Tiego sets on your staging, right? At least make sure that you have some, right? Try it with 3 or 4. Just customize your staging system to the needs you have, right? Someone else? Yeah? Yeah, we actually, how we doing it? So I told you that the slave conqueror is able to deploy the directors of its environment with its own director. We are kind of doing the same thing with our master. So the master is actually deploying the slave directors, which means you don't have to have the credentials lying in your 1Password or somewhere. The credentials are in the cred hub of the master. That's also the reason why we have 1 master per customer, because we don't want to have our secrets from customer A at the master of customer B. So with this, you basically don't have much trouble. You just go and just update the stem cell, and the credentials are in the master conqueror. Someone else? Okay, so I guess, yeah, we're gonna end the presentation. If you have any question left, just come tomorrow to our booth, we can have some chat, and I hope to see you soon. Thank you.